Good morning, everyone, to Full Stop in the WOW. This is the discipline that we have here. The all-important discipline to avoid the trap of understanding. We know that truth is true. And so letting go of any efforts to liberate anything is the WOW. We realize nothing needs to be liberated. It's the desire to liberate, which is the problem, which is what is the belief in no liberation as an abyss. As if God created, in God's perfect creation, there's something that needs to be liberated. This is absurd. So we have been engaged in a dream of absurdity. And this has to be seen without any levels to it. And so this is the WOW. As soon as we get into understanding, we're talking about levels and differentiation. So the entire key to recognition is to practice the WOW. Abide in the WOW of recognition rather than going into trying to understand recognition. This is the pivotal key. Without this, you're going to continue to be lost in the dream of liberation. Remember, the dream of liberation, what arose first was the arrogance of wanting to be greater than God, and then therefore automatically believing that there's something that you need to do to make this happen. And out of this, well, the idea that in God, in the perfection of God, something is less than perfect. And then the feeling that something's wrong, that you need to liberate this imperfection, to free it from imperfection. You know, this is the, so that therefore this is the action of being greater than God is to liberate that which is deficient, to increase what is deficient. This would be the activity. So when we want to be greater than God, we have to take on this mantle of some activity. And so then we end up seeing perfection, reality, as imperfect. And then need to liberate it from this imperfection. And so you have this dream then of existence where there's liberators and there's that which needs to be liberated. This is duality. So when you hear this, it's just go into the WOW of it. Not the understanding of it. Sure, we're using words, which could always tend to lean towards understanding, right? But we must be disciplined. We must have faith that the speaker is not calling us to understanding, but to the WOW of recognition. There are no levels at all. Never have been. There's no differences, there's no distinctions, there's nothing to understand whatsoever. Understanding is the activity of this attempt to be greater than God, of trying to understand, okay, well, what is it that's less, and what is it that's more? So we can get the less now to be equal to the more. Let's increase it. This is all, again, the activity. The dream activity, imaginary activity, of an imaginary greater than godness. So the original sin is arrogance, spiritual arrogance of trying to be greater than God. And just, that's all that needs to be seen, really. And then from there, from that root premise of what is our trouble, what does our trouble really come from, then we're able to see that this entire phantasmagoria of levels and liberators and those who need to be liberated, all of this arises simultaneously as the play of an imaginary new prime creator that's greater than the prime creator. It's like a movie that arises. So when you hear this, obviously there's nowhere to go with understanding. And then if you're not able to abide in the WOW, then understanding misinterprets the WOW as an abyss. When we think we're greater than God, if we think we get, we're giving that action up, activity up, we think there's nothing else, we'll just be an abyss. Because we see God as this problematical situation called existence. Now, when we misperceive, imagine this, that God is not perfect, this is, we see this dream, misinterpretation. And we think without that misinterpretation, there'll be nothing at all. This is the fear of the abyss. So, when we hear the truth like this, and try to understand it, we end up with a fear of the abyss. But if we just go into the wow, like, wow, this is true, wow, that's all just, oh my, shock, temporary shock. Then there's not the fear of the abyss. We embrace this wow and understand it's just continuity fear. We just have to get familiar with this, that's all. It's not an abyss, it's a familiarity problem. Again, this is pivotal. It's not fear. It's fear of the abyss. It's not an abyss. It's familiarity issue. So if we practice like this, it will become clearer and clearer and clearer to us, and we will not be afraid of seeing it all flat as it actually is, completely flat. And this is our, of course, our little play of being greater than God, seeing it as flat. That's not an abyss. We'll just realize we're not greater than God. We are God, but we're not greater than God. As soon as we see depth to any of this, that's the abyss. Right? That's really the abyss. And to see any depth at all in this dream of absurdity, this absurdist dream, any depth at all, it's completely flat. At which point we realize that there's only God. There's just God being God. All that arises is God being God. So there's nothing that needs liberation at all. It's impossible. It's absurd. So, what about all this practicing and all this stuff? Well, if we just see it as thinning out continuity fear, then we don't struggle with it. We're not worried about it. But there's a faster way. It's full stop in the wow. Is the fastest way to thin out this continuity fear. I'd say it's the safest way, the fastest way. Everyone's trying to find fast ways. Well, this is certainly both a safe way and a fast way. Both. That can be done right where one is. Because when we hear the truth, the real truth, the only really reaction we have is just, wow, I don't need to do any practices at all. This is the dawning realization. I'm not stuck in some graduated endeavor situation. This is the sudden enlightenment school. Chan Buddhism is an example of this. The Council of Lhasa, the graduated approach, won out, supposedly. And the sudden enlightenment school was banned. Dzogchen is really more of the sudden enlightenment school, which means focus on seeing it as all flat, totally. That no practices are needed at all to make it flat. This is the key. There are no practices at all needed to make it flat, to flatten absurdity. It's already flat. It's inherently flat. All absurdity is equally absurd. So the only practices, all they're doing is thinning out continuity fear, evaporating continuity fear, thinning out all concepts, thinning them out. That's all that's really happening. Now you can say there are many, many ways to thin this out. We can say that. And many of the so-called quick ways are very dangerous and require like gurus, very, very strong supervision by top enlightened gurus. Vajrayana Buddhism, for instance, the Yidam visualizations, deity visualizations, all the tantric types of practice, all these things. These are very, very potentially dangerous, actually. But the full stop in the wow is not. We're not trying to force anything. We're not working with energy at all. We're not working with visualization at all. None of that's needed, actually. You might say we're working with faith, our spiritual intuition. So many of these practices throughout history have been contingent on faith in the teachers, that the teachers will ultimately show them that none of these practices are really necessary at all. Okay, so there's a very heavy, heavy implicit faith in the teachers. It has to be. So it's a way of evaporating the continuity fear. All these various teachings are basically one way or another involved with that. But this full stop in the wow, I've been looking back in history and seeing that this is sort of the root, though, of the teaching. It's the highest teaching. Don't look forward. Don't project forward, plans forward. Don't look back and try to recall. Don't try to figure out what's going on right now. Don't try to think about it. Don't try to figure out. Don't scheme. Don't struggle. Just rest. Full stop. Just rest. Full stop. In the wow of this overall reaction that I don't need to do anything. No, nothing needs to be done. It's inherently flat. Absurdity is flat from the beginning. Flat in the middle. Flat at the end. Nothing to differentiate. And we talk about empty mind, no mindness. It means that this differentiation that's not really the mind. It's the mind trying to transcend the mind that gets into all this differentiation. So we might say no transcendent mind, just mind. Right? It's our efforts to transcend ourselves, transcend reality, which is the problem. So, seeing absurdity is just flat, completely flat, then there's nothing to say about it, is there? There's nothing to differentiate. So the differentiating involvement and the planning and remembering, okay, you know, well, oh, okay, how did I flatten it out? Or recalling, okay, now how did I do? Don't need that, do we? Or how am I going to flatten it out? We don't need that. Well, how is it that it's flat now? We don't need that. How do I figure out how to get this flatness? I don't need that. It's inherently flat. It's always been so. You see, God is not some great liberator. God has never got into that silly game. Okay. God just knows that all is perfect freedom. God created perfect freedom. So God knows God's creation. God is just knowing God's creation. That's it. And that's our natural condition as well. There isn't anything else. Just a silly, whimsical, absurdist dream. So the false mind, you might say that the false mind is seen as not needed. When they say no mind or emptiness, it means this false mind is not needed. We see that there isn't any need to differentiate. The desire to differentiate is desire to liberate. The desire to liberate is desire to be greater than God. So it's our arrogance that's the real problem. The arrogance of being liberators. There's no liberation. Nothing to liberate from. Absurdity has been flat from the very beginning. Nothing has ever happened. And so, of course, this type of talk can only be heard and accepted by those who are able to full stop in the wow. This is the discipline that is required. It's the one discipline. It's just one discipline. Not many. And the feeling is like you're almost like you're sitting and you feel like you're almost pinned back in your seat, like G-force is hitting you. Just, wow. All of this has just been a silly dream. Even the dream of bodhisattvas, infinite reincarnations, there's nothing to be reincarnated into. The idea that I'm going to be this great liberator, you know, coming back millions of times to liberate everyone, there's nothing to be born into. There's nothing to be liberated from. So it's our desire to be this great liberator that is actually the hindrance, actually the trouble. It starts from that. It starts from our arrogance to be greater than God. But then we say, okay, what is our action? We want to be greater than God. Well, how can we differentiate from God? And so it starts out with this differentiation. You say, well, I'm a liberator. But what does that mean? What do you mean liberator? Oh, well, there's all this sentient existence needs to be liberated from suffering. So we imagine all this suffering that we need to, you know, liberate these beings who are suffering. There's no beings that are suffering. It's all a dream. There's no suffering beings at all. And there's nothing that needs to be liberated at all. We can't be these great liberators, these great bodhisattvas of liberation. It's impossible. So again, this is the wow, wow. This is what I'm going through. We can't be greater than God. In God's creation, all is absolute perfection forever. So how could there be anything that needs to be liberated? That's absurd, completely absurd. So our desire to be greater than God gives rise to this action which we believe we have to liberate something from inferiority, which gives rise to this dream of existence, which makes us believe that there's being in this dream involved in lesser beingness. There's lesser beingness, so there's levels. And of course we're not aware of reality at this point, because there is no lesser being in reality. There's only God being in reality. There's not Bodhisattva being or Buddha being or Christ being or this being. There's only God being in reality. reality. So God being God is what's called the Son of God. There's God the prime creator, and the action of that is God being God, which is what's called God the Son. And we are that action. And then there's God the Holy Spirit, which is just reaffirming that there's nothing else other than that. Because in our freedom, we've tried to be greater than God. So the bad habit is the habit of trying to understand. The good habit, the effective habit, is full stop in the wow. So we're doing one of those two. And of course, there's also the habit of just not really paying attention to any of it, just not even interested in trying to recognize the truth. Just being absorbed in action here. So all of this has a ring of like, oh yeah, well this is why, yeah, this isn't this what the teachings are all about? It is, at one level. But the thing is when we, they're teachers, they're those who know this and share this here. But because of the continuity fear, it's misinterpreted. Eventually, misinterpretations arise. And then you get back into confusion. So it's like you have to continually refresh here. Refresh the truth. The truth has to be refreshed. As we keep thinning out continuity fear. But what happens is when we try to understand, then that's when we start making things worse. When it becomes academic. When our upbringing becomes an academic upbringing, this then makes things worse. And then we begin bifurcating everything into understanding and not understanding, into levels, into all sorts of different levels. So there's a pragmatic teaching which recognizes that everyone has different levels of continuity fear and an attempt to account for all that. But this is only a pragmatic teaching. It's not a real teaching. It's just the pragmatism. But we can't lose sight of what the actual goal of this is, what we're actually dealing with. And we have to have the discipline of full stop on the wow instead of understanding. All this understanding we have is just arrogance. And it's how we play, pretend to be greater than God. So the truth is very, very different than what understanding wants us to believe. Understanding the root premise of that is more and less differentiation. That's a denial of perfection. And the root of full stop in the wow is the acceptance of perfection. We must accept that perfection is perfection. Perfection does truly, quote unquote, exist. And when we have experiences, glimpses of perfection, that really helps us. And then we realize, oh my gosh, everything else is just an ego trip. Perfection always exists right now. There's no capturing of it. There's no triumphs leading to it. Nothing leads to it. Nothing attains it. That's all still the dream of trying to be greater than God. Entirely, all of it. So this dream of trying to be greater than God has been, we try to spiritualize it, of course. We're spirit. So it's all spiritualized. But that doesn't change you one bit. And then we make the mistake of trying to secularize it. Say, well, let's get rid of the spiritualization of it. Then it'll be easier to see through. Maybe. I have to look at that. You know, is it getting easier for us, right? As we de-spiritualize it all? But this is the cyclic problem of absurdity. Absurdity is always trying to say, wait a minute, I think I have the answer. It's spiritualized? Okay, let's de-spiritualize it. Which is what the trends are now. And then there's a countering that. So no, we need to make it more spiritual. Let's spiritualize it. Let's de-spiritualize it. So we're cycling through this, spiritualizing and de-spiritualizing, spiritualizing, de-spiritualizing. What you're hearing in the background is rain. Heavy at times. Well, not real heavy, but so absurdity is always saying, oh, I think I have the answer. I need to de-spiritualize it. That says, oh, yeah, I think I have the answer. I need to spiritualize it. So we're just ping-ponging back and forth. Is the goal a spiritualized culture? No. Is it a de-spiritualized culture? No. It's sort of a medium in between, which is, that's not the goal, but I would say that if we can hold sort of a balance of not going to either extreme, the dissatisfaction that we feel can be turned into a wow. We could look at it as a wow, because absurdity is very dissatisfied with that. And from this middle type of path, we're able to recognize the entire situation for what it really is. So we might say that this last 50 years or so has been an ideal time here, where the trends of de-spiritualization and spiritualization have come together both strong enough to sort of balance one another out. And then this has helped us get free of the entire paradigm here, the falsity of it all. Of course, it's very dissatisfying to absurdity. Says, come on, well, which one are we going to have? Which one are we going to do? Let's commit to one way or the other. So unless we're practicing full stop in the wow, we will go one way or the other. And so this is the conflict in the world. Now there's this push for a secular type of world, and there's a push for a spiritual, religious type of world, right? But both are absurd. The whole thing is absurd. It's just that all the defense of absurdity, all of this, is a distraction device. The world, bodies, personalities, beings, sentient beings, all of this is a distraction device we have imagined, distracting us away from recognition that all absurdity is simply nothing at all. It's completely flat. It doesn't extend at all. There's nothing to it at all. It's a distraction device, a dream of distraction. So we're not aiming to be some great Buddha, great this, great that. We're just aiming for our natural state, which is just God being God. That's all there is. God loving God, God loving God. God loving being God is all there is. And this does not require any sort of sentient existence whatsoever. This is done in essence, idea in essence, formless. All of the so-called, but actually everything is already that way. It's all, we're just receiving it all in our desire to be greater than God. Don't try to understand this, though. Spirit already knows this. Reality knows this. So it's getting used to this, which is just, wow, not understanding. I can tell you that those who try to use understanding, it doesn't work. Like a lifetime of studying. You can have a library of esoteric books and you will die still spinning your wheels. Still saying, well, I didn't quite make it. Make what? There's nothing to make. There's no grade to make at all. God is oblivious to this idea of grades. There's only God loving God. That's it. There's no absurdity at all in God loving God. God the Father, God the Son. And then God the Holy Spirit saying, there isn't anything else. It's just all blessings are here now. All blessings are here now. All blessings are here now. Now, in looking, studying some of the great teachings, etc., looking at them, there, a lot of them are right out of the money. I mean, they speak in slogans. It's very important to use these shorthand slogans. But what do those slogans do? They have the impact to give rise to the wow. Whereas academic talk is trying to avoid the wow. Because in the wow, there doesn't seem to be any advancement. Right, because there are no levels. There are no graduated levels. Nothing, no distinction. So what has to be accomplished? Nothing. There's nothing that needs to be accomplished. There's nothing we have to do. I call these slogans, I call them affirmations, assertions, assert. So this, the teaching is three parts. That these assertions help us. These lead to this wow feeling. Like, wow, there's nothing. I'm already free. All blessings are here now. I am God, loving God, being God. Everything is. I'm going to accept this. I'm going to stop all this foolishness. This is a wow. And then the commentary on this, the exhortation, encouragement, is called flipping the script. So to back off the wow, we do some commentary. And then to build up the wow, we use the assertions. But this is really just the heart of all the teachings that have been given in this world. This is really the heart of it right here. But it shouldn't be anything more or less. We shouldn't make anything more of it, nor should we make anything less of it. And then that also produces the wow. So we have to realize how much wow is being produced. Like, well, I don't need to do anything. No one needs to do anything. Nothing needs to be accomplished. So our speed is just is how much we can continue to abide in this wow, and some, you know, really dedicate themselves to it, and they go quite quickly towards the vision of sameness, the vision of oneness, vision of Christ. It's all the same. Speaking of just this absolute flatness to absurdity, there's just no depth at all. And no way to generate any depth. Simply contrasting labels is no depth at all. It's an illusory depth. Very silly. And again, just hear this and full stop in the wow. There's no class to graduate from. There's no grade to receive. No teacher, no teaching, no student. Truly, this is so. There's no teacher, there's no teaching, and there's no student. So this simplification of it that we have now is due to a number of factors. It's Ram Maharshi was very helpful, actually, in all this. He had a greatly simplifying effect on it all through his silence. He said, it's okay to realize that there's nothing really needs to be said at all. All blessings are right now. So that had a very, very helpful effect. Then the great radical Dzogchen teachings like Longchenpa, who just said, look, forget all this graduated endeavor. That's all delusion. Very helpful. So the full stop in the wow is designed so we don't run back into some practice. Because we get start feeling, oh, I need to practice up here. I need to practice up here. I need to do something. You have to be committed to not doing anything, not practicing anything. No graduated endeavor at all. No graduated endeavor at all. Just full stop in the wow. Don't allow your mind to jump back into some graduated of higher and lower, greater, lesser, good and bad. Keep in mind, absurdity, the way it keeps this dream going is saying, well, it's sorting out, it's purifying. It's sorting out good absurdity from bad absurdity. The bifurcation of this. This is what keeps us deluded. Good and bad absurdity. There is no good and bad absurdity. There's just absurdity. There are no levels to it. Believing that we can be other than God, loving God, is absurdity. There are no levels to it. We're just imagining all these levels to it. This is absurdity defending absurdity. It's all that it is. Absurdity defending absurdity. That's all that it is, absurdity defending absurdity. And of course, we're the ones who are entertaining absurdity, so we have all this creativity engaged, and this creativity is certainly capable of just producing endless fantasies of absurdity, liberating absurdity. When we say don't take any action, both physically, body, speech, mind, don't take any action in any of those, with your body, with your questioning, and then with your mind, analyzing, imagining, projecting, recalling, any of that. None of that mental action, none of the speech action of dialogue, questioning, that kind of, and then no physical action, just sit quietly. So these three, full stop in the round, all three aspects. Now, you can provide your own insight, because truth is within us. You can be your own teacher, so to speak, and like I'm doing my own commentary. So I'm speaking, but from the standpoint of truth, and then I'm practicing full stop in the wow as I'm saying this, not doing anything with body, no body action, no questioning of what I'm saying. I don't question it. I'm just accepting, hearing it and accepting it. And then I'm not engaging in any practice, graduated practice. I just full stop in the wow of it. So it's the ferry boat, the one who's ferrying those across the river. They also are ferried across the river as they carry their passengers across. So we could literally do this ourselves, actually. The empowerments we get from those who have already done this is they help us, encourage us, and we get glimpses of perfection. So if you've had a glimpse of perfection, then theoretically you can do this practice wherever you are. You can be your own teacher. Now this has been done before in books, or having a teacher talk, or books that someone reading, the inspired books like that. So this is really, it's not different than it's just a refreshment of it here. We're not reinventing the wheel here, actually. It's a refreshment of it. You know, the wheel's gotten kind of square. We're just smoothing it out so it's round again. That's all. And we don't need to make any assessment beyond that of fault and blame or victory and this and that. That's all absurdity. It's just the only teaching that happens in the world here, really, is we just keep reminding everyone that the wheel is still round. It's still round. It's not square. So just keep with this basic essential practice is all that's required. You don't need to make the wheel square and then figure out how to get a smooth ride. You know, it's kind of like we've made square wheels, and we're frantically working on all the, you know, shock absorber structure of our car. So, wow, this ride is really bumpy. You know, how do we smooth this ride out? And so we're working to get better shocks, all this hydraulic systems, super hydraulic systems. So we say, oh, okay, I've smoothed it out a little bit, so not so bumpy of a ride. And we're not even looking at the tires to say, oh my gosh, we've built this, like we put some square rubber on the tires, so we made them square. That's the problem. Just get the wheels round, and then the ride will be smooth automatically. Absurdity is to make the wheels square and then obsess about how do we get this ride smooth, and to think that, wow, we're really engaged with great liberation efforts here. We're smoothing out the ride. And yet completely ignoring this absurdity of making the tires square. Completely ignoring that. That's absurdity. And absurdity is the only way we can imagine functioning as something greater than God. It's an absurdist functionality, actually. And we're just trying to hide that. This is the game we're playing. We're trying to hide the absurdity, the flatness of it, so we can pretend that we're greater than God. Plain and simple. So if you point out that, hey, just make the wheels round, they say, what? World says, what? Absurdity says, what? That's no accomplishment. That, what kind of accomplishment can we have then? That's ridiculous. I mean, we wouldn't need to do all this hydraulic work. I mean, it would just, the ride would be inherently smooth. That, we can't be greater than God if we do that. We got to find a way to be greater than God here. So let's make the ride bumpy. Let's imagine that it's bumpy. Let's imagine that God isn't God and that we're suffering, that God is a state of suffering, of inferiority. And let's figure out how to help God out. So all this attempt to liberate is really based on a desire to help God out, to liberate God from some inferiority, so that God can be brought into the fullness of the new creation, that we're the new prime creators. You know, it's absurd. It's completely absurd. Don't try to understand this. Don't struggle. So we are not rejecting the great teachers, not at all. We are reaffirming and refreshing and just stating again, the wheels are just, the wheels are round. We're just imagining them to be square. Now the sudden school of enlightenment, in Buddhism it's called the sudden school, that we sort of turned into radical Dzogchen, and it is, they say, look, you don't need all these yantras and mantras and tantras and all this kind of stuff. You don't need to try to empower the world, empower yourself and do all that. No, that, okay, you don't need that. Skillful beads can turn anything into a practice, really, but then it becomes so bifurcated, you know, it's better to just have this one practice of just full stop in the wow. That's all that's needed. We don't need to obsess about, well, could we do it this way? Could we do it this way? Could we do it this way? Full stop in the wow is just getting used to no practice, actually. That's all that it is. Just getting used to no practice. There's nothing that needs to be practiced. How could perfection need to practice something? How could perfection practice liberating something? What could there possibly be in perfection that needs to be made perfect? So again, a glimpse, when you get these glimpses, Jesus calls it a holy instant. He has his own terminology, which is, has continuity with the Christian tradition for the sake of continuity. It's not that these things have to be, this terminology needs to be used at all, no. So there's no conflict among terminologies, really. It's only teaching reaches down and has to thin out the continuity fear. And so there's various traditions, and these traditions have ways of reaching down and thinning out the continuity if you're helping out with that. So Jesus calls it the holy instant, which is just a glimpse of perfection, which is right now. And then this glimpse of perfection, this is the seed that sprouts within us. And we start to realize, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to practice. All I need to practice is non-practicing. But this is itself a very profound, difficult discipline, because we're so obsessed with graduated efforts in all different ways, in infinite ways, really. That to not practice is just like a mind blower. We think it's an abyss. You know, it's just, can I survive this abyss of not practicing? And so you have to prove to yourself it's not an abyss. And this goes slowly. It can go slowly. So this can seem to be a slower path at first. It's the rabbit, the tortoise and the hare sort of thing. Continue with graduated endeavor. Seems to be fast path, fast, fast. I'm practicing. This feels normal to me. I feel good. And we're full stop in the wild. Says, whoa, you know, wow. This seems real difficult. It's going to go slow. It's so slow. But as you really do it, you pick up momentum, and then it goes faster and faster and faster. So it starts out slow, but ends up going really fast. Whereas graduate endeavor starts out real fast and then ends up going really slow. And then the hare goes to sleep again. So I'm tired. I've been running so fast. But graduate endeavor says, I'm not tired. I've been kind of going kind of slow, and I'm building up stamina, and now I'm going real fast, but it's okay, because I have the foundation there of I can full stop in the wow anytime. I've got the break there. It's like riding a vehicle. And it's like, oh, it's too smooth. What happened? Something terrible happened. Because we're so used to the bumpy ride. If the ride becomes smooth, they say, what's wrong? What's wrong? What happened? So we interpret this smoothness as something's gone wrong. With what? Well, what we think reality is the way that we're dreaming of it, that there's something wrong with reality that we're fixing. We're fixing God. We think I saw some imperfection in God, and we're fixing God so that all can be perfect. And so if we feel the perfection right now, we say, whoa, something weird just happened. So we, at that point, full stop in the wow. We know what's going on intuitively. We just glimpse perfection. Take no action. No physical action. No argumentative, speech action. No querulous quibbles and all this stuff that play of concepts, play of words, that, you know, none of that stuff. And then no mental action in terms of recall or planning or thinking about what happened or trying to figure anything out. Making plans or just digressing from the whole thing, having a fantasy to just none of that. We don't set it down. We don't put plans to pick it up. We don't take two plans to set it down. We try to take no mental action either, and to just rest in the wow, full stop in the wow, just rest in the wow. This is really the sovereign practice that's been brought out in the past in various ways, reaching down into a system of continuity fear, okay, helping them where they're at with their symbology and contrasting of symbology. It's all symbolic, this dream, so it's just contrasting symbols, which is nothing at all, completely flat actually. and don't no striving for understanding. It's simpler than understanding entirely. It's a completely simple, completely flat. Absurdity is completely flat. Nothing to understand there. As soon as we try to understand flat, we're thinking of not flat. And so we're then imagining an endeavor-based self that needs to do some flattening, some action of flattening. So there's no flattener. So this is letting go of the I, the false self, the false mind, all this. There's no flattener. There's no flattener. There's no hero of the dream at all. No heroine either, actually. Okay, absurdity says, no hero, no problem. Is he careful about this? This is the essential cycling that absurdity does. And we have to be very adamant about this. And this is what absurdity wants us to overlook. The absurdity will say, oh yeah, I get it now. There's no hero of the dream. Okay, finally, I have reached enlightenment. I understand exactly what you're talking about. And then you look back at absurdity a little while later, and what do they have? They're championing a heroine of the dream. And absurdity says, well, you said there was no hero. I mean, I'm just taking your teaching, doing exactly what you said to do. I totally understand what you're talking about. That, yeah, the hero of the dream, that's terrible, terrible. But heroine of the dream, wonderful. And this is exactly what's happening right now. This is the reaction of absurdity to the higher teachings, okay? It reacts to the real teaching. But what happened in our culture is we started to get glimpses of perfection more and more, and then we started to say, hey, and we started getting with it, actually. And absurdity had this this knee-jerk reaction. And at first it sided with us. I said, wow, you guys are really doing great. All of you are doing great. And then it said, well, I thoroughly understand. Don't worry, I've got it. Now I've got it. And what did it do? It then went into this frantic, frantic effort to remodel the symbology, the contrast in symbols. And so now it has a heroine of the dream that instead of a hero. And it says, well, I did exactly what you told me to do, so shut up. You know, you got no complaints. And we laugh because it's so shocking. You know, it's like, oh my gosh. This is what I call the yoga girl trap. Is instead of, of course, when we say no heroes of the dream, we're talking about on a mental level, not the gender level. But of course, absurdity has to refuse to see it that way and says, no, you're just being sexist. Let's get rid of sexism. Let's call it a heroine of the dream. We've solved the problem. So it always confounds itself like this, always. And so we have so many people into spirituality now, but they're into being the heroines of the dream and supporting the idea that there's a heroine of the dream who will fix the problems. And this is just absolutely just more of the same nonsense. Nothing has changed with absurdity at all. It's completely flat, but this is how it works. It's very tricky, but it's actually completely blatant. It thinks it's being tricky. It thinks it's finding a way around. It says, ah, okay, so I can't be greater than God this way as a hero, but I can be greater than God as a heroine. Okay, now I got it. Thanks for the teaching. You know, this is how absurdity responds to this teaching. We have to be aware of this. I said, oh, okay, the way to be greater than God is you can't do it as a male, but as a female, as a heroine, oh yeah, you can do it that way. It's a secret way. It's a subtler way. It's a more mysterious way. It's a goddess way. You know, it's a This is absurdity. And later on, it will just flip-flop again. As frustrations with this build, it will say, oh yeah, you can't do it as a hero one way, but as a hero, absolutely you can do it. Gotta do it as a hero. It just cycles through this nonsense. Cycles of nonsense. Ping-ponging. Is all that absurdity does. And it also, there's temporary alignment. It temporarily aligns, saying, oh yeah, yeah, you got the spiritual, okay, you're really getting it now, it's great. And you're getting it so much, it says that now I understand it too. I really get it. No, absurdity always bifurcates, makes it dualistic, and then says one part of the dualism's bad, the other's good. And then later on, it'll switch sides and say, wait a minute, okay, the side that I thought was good absurdity, now I see it's bad absurdity. And the side that I thought was bad absurdity, now I see it as good absurdity. Okay, I finally reached clarification. And then later on, it'll just flip-flop back the other way. And so we're flip-flopping. Just keep flip-flopping, flip-flopping, flip-flopping. Now, okay, wow, strong wow reaction. I'm feeling tired now. I'm feeling like this is really, you know, it's very strong wow, very profound, and it's not flattening anything out. It's just seeing the flatness that's already there. So our fatigue is part of absurdity also, because absurdity says, wow, you must have been incredibly tiring action you must have taken to flatten this all out. And so our fatigue is the evidence absurdity demands that we succeeded. So the price of our success absurdity demands of us is this extreme exhaustion, which is why I've been exhausted, extremely exhausted my whole life. Absurdity says, you want to be a great teacher, a liberator, whatever, great. Okay, but you got to pay the price. It's going to be extreme exhaustion because, wow, what a huge effort it is to level all this. So I got pulled down into that, and maintaining this desire to help out here, then I felt duality demanded this extreme exhaustion from me, which is my whole life I've been extremely exhausted. It's the worst suffering ever. This is just absurdity. Insisting, well, you know, you have to be exhausted because it's so incredibly difficult to level all this down. I mean, it's just no one's ever done such a difficult job. It's just so, it must be incredibly tiring to you. And if you don't have the exhaustion, absurdity says, well, you didn't do anything. So how could you be a teacher? How could you claim that you've done something when you haven't done anything? There's no exhaustion. How could you have done anything? I say, well, there's nothing to do. Nothing needs to be done at all. And absurdity will say, well, that's absurd. Right, that's the nature of absurdity. There's nothing that needs to be done. It's all flat from the very inherently. Well, you're talking about an abyss. That's what he's saying. No, absurdity is the abyss. We're talking about perfect, God-loving God, no abyss, no possibility of abyss. And absurdity says, well, I don't understand what to do. Well, absurdity doesn't have to do anything. And so we just full stop in the wow with this. It's funny, all these raindrops, this is very odd, all these raindrops on the windshield here, they were round when it was raining, and now the rain has stopped, the sun is out, they've all turned squarish. Seriously. I've been looking at these, I said, why are all the raindrops in an erect square pattern now? Really, like salt crystals, actually. They're all square on my windshield. Very amazing corollary to what we're speaking of here. Now, I assume that's because there's some dust and dirt on the windshield, and that gets into the water, dissolving the water. But there's a lot of rain on the windshield. It seems it should have washed all that off. But, and of course, that one might cause the water to take on a crystalline shape. every drop is a different shape, as though, isn't that amazing? Slightly different. There's no two that are exactly the like. We talk about trillions of stars in, you know, the galaxy, the universe, trillions and trillions. Well, how many raindrops are there in a big rainstorm? How many raindrops fall? I mean, I'm just looking at my windshield here, and there's thousands upon thousands upon thousands of drops just here in the windshield. Good Lord. And this is just a tiny little area, just for just a moment here. Take a huge area with raindrops ceaselessly pounding down. There's probably trillions of raindrops coming down. Each one similar to each other, and each one also none quite exactly the same. Now Jesus tells us, well, let me not push ahead too much. Because I have to acknowledge this the wow here factor that I'm in. When we're talking about raindrops, we're flipping the script a little bit. We're cooling down. There's a cool down period here of the wow. Where we don't really know what to do because we just realize there's nothing we need to do. Now, functionality here doesn't have to be quote unquote a doing of a fixing. Doesn't have to be goal oriented in terms of absurdity, flattening absurdity. We can just go about just pragmatic functioning here. That's not a problem really. It doesn't counterman what we've been talking about here. We still have continuity fear, and everybody else does here too. We've had some great teachers come here, notably Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, who told us some amazing teachings. What she said, if you really know, listen carefully, what she said. She said her body didn't have any needs at all. But she only pretended to have needs for our sake, so she could reach us here in our continuity fear and wouldn't scare us too much. And she's very just offhandedly, you know, everything she said was just sort of offhand, casual, offhand, no big deal about it. So in order to reach us here in our massive continuity fear, to have a body, we need to have a body appear, generally speaking, because people are so obsessed with absurdity and needing to do something about it, flatten it out. They think we need a body, we need a body, we need a body. So we think the teacher has to have a body. They're helping us flatten out absurdity, which they're not. They're actually not. But conventionally, she said, okay, I'll have a body appearance. But she never identified with the body appearance in the slightest regard. She never took it to be herself at all. She said, this only body's only for the sake of you here. And if you don't want to use the body will just be inert like a rag doll. And when they lost interest in what she was helping them with, the body would just collapse and turn into this just inert, frozen body there, like a doll, rag doll. This is true. It literally happened this way. And then when they say, okay, we understand, we're going to pay more better attention, the body would revive. But she never identified with the body in the slightest. And so as far as the body's needs, functional needs, she said there aren't any, actually. I don't need to eat. I don't need to sleep. Might even say, don't even need to breathe. And Jesus said this also, all needs are just projected upon the body. Body doesn't have any needs at all, actually. But for the sake of reaching down to us in our continuity fear, she pretended that this body had needs. And she said, so she negotiate with us. He negotiated. And so they went through this dance of negotiation. The whole life was a dance of negotiation, of trying to get more and more concessions from us. You know, it's like, well, how much do you want me to eat? So they'd tell her, we want you to eat a whole lot. I mean, it was really scaring the heck out of us. She said, oh, you want me to eat a whole lot? Oh, okay. And then she started eating, and she wouldn't stop. And then she would eat up enough food for 100 people. It was crazy. And people would say, whoa, stop, what are you doing? You're going to kill yourself. And she goes, well, you told me to eat a lot. You didn't tell me to stop. Oh, gosh, this is horrible. Don't eat so much. She says, oh, well, how much do you want me to eat? And they go through all this dance of negotiation. And the food just seemed to disappear. She'd just eat, enough to explode, 100 stomachs, and it had no effect on her. They say, we want you to fatten up, you're too thin. And then she'd fatten up. And they say, wait a minute, okay, a little too fat. And then thin down, then she thinned down. And so, okay, don't eat so much. And she said, well, okay, I'm not interested in eating anymore then. And she stopped eating. And wait, you got to eat some. And, well, okay, I only want to eat just a piece of fruit that has naturally fallen off a tree and has to be very pure. All this. And so she put them through all this rigmarole. Eventually, it got down to just one grain of rice a day. But that rice had to be cooked exactly right and pure and all this stuff. So she tortured him with this rigmarole of negotiating. It was like this very intense negotiating thing that was always going on. And so there was this tension there. It's like, what is she going to do next to us, And she always would get around there, They said, okay, we pinned you down now. And then she'd find some way to say, well, you didn't say this. Wait a minute. Oh, no, here she goes again. Drove him crazy. And they're just like, oh, my gosh. They'd say, what are you doing traveling at night? She says, what do you mean night? Well, it's all dark. She says, nah, perfectly bright, bright as can be. I don't see any darkness at all. But your eyes, how could I see? She says, I don't use my eyes to see. What are you talking about? Well, no, you're supposed to use the body's eyes to see. She says, well, I'm just not able to do that, Or, okay, then she'd play stupid. Like, well, I can't do this now anymore. I'm just using the body to see. I can't do this. I can't do that. I say, no, wait a minute. Okay, let's negotiate this too. Drove them crazy. It's just, that's why their other faces were always like pain expression. You see, it's like, ah. You think like, oh, they're being blessed, they're devotees. No, they were like, oh, my God, this headache. I just can't seem to put her in any box. Can't box her. This is like so difficult. Always negotiating, and then she finds a way to break, somehow wiggle free of those negotiations. That's not easy. That was brutal. But of course, this is bringing through frustration like this, bringing us to recognition. Now, she did this to me by saying, well, I'm coming back. I'm coming real soon. Got to get ready for me. I said, oh, how do I prepare for you? I got to do this. I got to do that. So I went through all these preparations trying to prepare. And she said, well, you haven't prepared properly. Well, what's proper preparation? So her teaching actually continued on, even when the body wasn't here, of saying, well, I'm coming back. I'm going to get another body. You want me back? Well, I have another body. Well, how are you going to take care of this body? This is what she said to me. Well, you want me back? I said, yeah. Well, how are you going to take care of this body? She says, I'm not coming back until you know how to take care of the body. And I said, well, okay, how do I take care of a body like this? I got to understand her mind, and all this. And so put me through this horrible time of stress and strain. How does she gonna dress? I got to get the right clothes for her. How's she? She says, well, I'm not even interested in clothes or anything. Well, here, okay, well, let's find something you are interested in. Dress you this way or that way, or how do we? Oh, I don't know. I just have no interest. How do I deal with something like this? So this terrible challenge I had of how am I going to deal with a body like this? You know, it's just horrible. And finally, just don't come back. Forget it. It's just, you don't want me to come back? No, not really. You know. Well, then, what are you going to do? Oh, I don't know, huh? So it put you in this real tough spot of. Yeah, I need help, but the help's really not worth it either. So maybe I just give up all this endeavor to flatten out absurdity. You know, maybe I just. So she kept pointing out the difficulty of absurdity to us, how difficult it is. And then the other empowerments came, like Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi Longchenpa. I already had the Jesus empowerment. And saying, hey, Longchenpa says, hey, you know, there's nothing to flatten out. And so then I become less and less interested in Ananda Mayama body coming back. You know, less and less interested. I say, forget about it. I don't need you. Don't need you to come back. No, thank you. Now we think it's the goddess has come to bless everyone. No. That's what they thought. That's what they're hoping for. But she frustrated the heck out of them. This is a fact. I know this. I know Ananda Mayama extremely well. I know this Leela of Sadhana, this dance that she did here in the world, extremely well. And it continued on, even when her body wasn't here. I've been put through the ringer, so I understand what it's about. It's a type of frustration thing. It's a really accelerated path. Where, and then she'd say, only I ask of you, if you get angry, just get angry with me and with no one else. That's one of the key precepts that she used. So I got very angry with her. I've been very angry. It's like, you promise this, you promise that, you break all your promises, you do this. She says, well, you're not ready. I say, well, you're supposed to get me ready. And how come I'm not ready? You're failing. She says, well, you know, in silence. And get angry. But I try to, she said, just get angry with me. That's okay. Don't get angry at anyone else. Just get angry with me. She says, that's great. That's an ornament. I love that. Okay. So teachers could teach even when they're not here, actually. Ram Maharshi said he would teach even better when he's not here. I don't know how that's possible. But that's what he said. But you see the devotees of Ananda Mayama, like Baiji, you know, and he's got this just pained expression on his face, like it's torture. She's torturing him. They all look like they're being tortured. And here she is, this blissful, happy, you know, and smiling like everyone thinks, oh, it's the goddess. She's so nice, so loving. Just everything's fine around her, so perfect. Oh my gosh. And yet her devotees are just like we've just been absolutely put through the ringer here, and we just don't know what the heck to do about it. Well, now we do know what to do about it. She's like it was like a divine problem that we needed to solve, and we don't need to do anything at all to flatten absurdity. There's nothing we need to do. So this teaching, this sharing here, is in some measure from the help of Ananda Mayama. Absolutely it is. From the help of Ram Maharshi, absolutely. From the help of Longchenpa, from the help of Jesus. It absolutely is due to that. they helped in different ways. Thin out the continuity fear from different angles, since continuity fear believes in so many angles, since absurdity believes in angles, that absurdity has these infinite angles, we see there's no angles at all. Ultimately, no angles at all. We're looking towards that. No angles at all. There's no angles to absurdity. How can the contrast of mere label be called an angle? That in itself is absurd. So you may not get an onto my back the body, but what you see is God loving God, which is what she actually was anyway. What these, all these teachers are is just God loving God. And then you are that also. As well, you are that as well. And whether there's a body here or not, it's all the same. That too is just God loving God. It's all of it is already that. And this is this higher teaching of even lies are true. Right? Even body is God loving God. Even dirt is God loving God. There's no difference anywhere. We're breaking the rain here. Beautiful. So full stop in the wow with all this. Absurdity tries to interpret all this for us and says, don't worry, I got it now. Yeah, I understand, there is bad absurdity. I'm all over it now. Okay, I've really been educated about this. I'm sorry about the bad part of absurdity, but I'm working to get rid of it. I'm working to purify it. Really, I'm really dedicated to purifying it. We must not allow that to usurp our efforts here. This is the discipline. You just say, no, full stop in the wow. We're not making anything of this right now. There's nothing to make of it. There's no progress to make of it. There's no momentum to make of it. There's nothing to make of it. How can we experience the now if we have all this momentum, spiritual momentum? Because that's momentum to I need to do something I haven't yet done. So I can't realize it now. I have too much momentum to the future of doing stuff in the future. That's absurdity. So that's called the ego. The ego is absurdity. It will just, the ego is the voice of absurdity. And it will say, oh, wow, okay, you really educated. This great teacher. Okay, I really got to get after it now. So much I got to do. So much purification I got to do. Wow. It's just, I got to really. No purification is needed. There are no defilements. There's no impurity. Absurdity hasn't done anything to perfection. Nothing at all. So that must be true right now, right? And absurdity always says, well, it will be true as soon as we flatten out the untruth. So still we get rid of the untruth, then it'll be true. No, it is no untruth. There's no untruth. All truth is true right now. So I can get kind of a feeling. I have a feeling of when we're starting to get irritated. It's like too much. It's like, oh, okay, can't handle anymore. All right, so. But you know, we'll let this subside, just like the rain is finished, the rain clouds. There's a little break in the rain, and we'll want to hear this again. Everything is true. All illusions are true. All lies are true. All deception is true. Everything is true right now. It's all true. So nothing has to be done. Nothing can separate from its own intrinsic spaciousness. No ideas can separate from their own intrinsic freedom. This issue of fatigue is very interesting. This interests me quite a bit because this has been my suffering, hideous cross. Absurdity says there's a cross you got to carry. Price you got to pay, obviously. There's no price you have to pay because there's nothing that needs to be done. Okay. There's an argument about whether Jesus paid the price or not. And Jesus has said in A Course in Miracles, no, I just pretended to for your sake, for your continuity, for your sake. That you allow me to come here to teach this as long as you could say, well, at some point we can kill you. Make you pay the price for it, for our listening. He said, okay, you can kill the body, but I'll raise it up again, no problem. So did Jesus suffer on the cross? Not really, no. No. There's no price to be paid. So this is a debate within Christianity. It's been a long-term debate. And a still ongoing debate. Okay, it depends on how much continuity fear you have. So the idea of winning a debate or not is ridiculous because everybody's speaking from their own level of continuity fear. When you thin out the continuity fear, then your perspective will change. So we don't hold anybody to some continuity fear-based perspective. This is what Jesus says, forgiveness, 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 forgive everyone, because they're just speaking from the level of continuity fear that they have now. Later on, when it's thinned out, they'll sing a different song. So there's this institutional desire to get everybody on the same page, to make the bureaucracy smoother of the institution. If you have everybody on different pages, how can you have an institution? How can you have a smooth functioning? You see, so you have Catholicism, which was an attempt to smooth out Christianity. Then you have Protestantism, which is willing to put up with a lot of different levels of continuity fear. And they don't have such a smooth bureaucracy. It's not so institutionally smooth as Catholicism. But in making it institutionally smooth, you throw out the baby with the bathwater. You're working on the hydraulics instead of the tires. You know, the tires are square, but trying to work on the hydraulics. So the Chalcedonian Creed of Jesus being both human and divine is not true. It's false. It's a false creed. But it led to then the institutionalization of Christianity in the Holy Roman Empire, which was a bureaucratic triumph. It was a triumph of institution and bureaucracy. But what lost out was truth. So absurdity had the upper hand. The continuity fear was still strong enough, so absurdity had the upper hand. And the Reformation, Lutheran Reformation, put grace back in the ascendancy over absurdity, and it says, "Look, we've got things backwards here. We're serving the institution instead of the institution serving us." And we'll have to put up with some raggedness to it. And so you have many different sects of Protestantism. All different. Every Protestant church you go to is different, right? And so you can't really govern them easily, right? They can't be this overarching bureaucracy and institution with it. And so it seems kind of ragged. And this is what the New World Order doesn't like. It wants this massive, smoothed-out bureaucracy, which is why the Vatican is so much in favor of it. Actually, the Vatican and the Pope Emeritus, because I excommunicated him, excommunicated him, so to speak. Really, I'm just speaking from the standpoint of truth. They're all for the New World Order. They're helping it vastly in that direction. At the same time, maintaining a pious stance. Of course, absurdity knows how to do that. But you have to put up with some raggedness in the world here. You cannot come in and say, okay, I'm going to sweep everything up into one institution, one in bureaucracy. That's absurdity, because that's just absurdity. Say, we need to streamline the effort to flatten out absurdity, to get rid of bad absurdity. Got to get rid of the evil. Got to streamline it. Got to do good works here. Let's get everybody on the same page. That's a huge, huge mistake. Now, Catholicism, you know, used to be much more ragged in a lot of ways, and there's always been a dynamic here, dialectic of trying to keep it bureaucratized, and kind of then it's slipping away from bureaucratizing. And there'd be all these saints. There are many saints, Christian saints, and the people would really venerate these saints and get great help and teaching from them. And then the Vatican would come in, and the bishops would support this, and the Vatican would try to centralize it all. So there's this tug of war between diffusion from the bishop's standpoint, and then cohesion from the Vatican standpoint. So there's been this tug of war throughout Catholicism, and it's now worse than ever. But it's always been going on. The history of it, if you look at it, it's always been going on. And right now, though, there is a huge tug of war going on between the attempt to centralize it all in the Vatican, crush the authority of popes to run their bishopric see, their dioceses, the way they want to, the way that the people can thin out their continuity fear to go in that way. See, that's what they realize, that this is what's effective. Whereas the Vatican says, well, we want a streamlined bureaucracy, and we want to keep this institution big and strong. And with this New World Order coming in, they want to find a way to have a major role in that. And the New World Order demands, of course, that the bishops lose their power, because that's ragged in their eyes, viewpoint. We've got to get everyone on the same page. We've got to regulate everything. So the Vatican's going along with the New World Order. Absolutely it is. Unless he's some genius subversive of it, but I think he's playing too smart of a game. Then he's outsmarting himself if that's the case. If you don't take a stand at some point, you may find out you have nowhere to stand. I mean, we can always look at it in a charitable way and say maybe he's just trying to outsmart the New World Order by pretending to go along with it. You know, you could, that's a charitable explanation of what's going on. Very charitable. Now, if you want to look at it that way, fine. But I would call this outsmarting yourself very likely is outsmarting yourself and underestimating the New World Order and the reptilian extraterrestrial aspect of it, which the Vatican is very aware of, by the way. They're very aware of extraterrestrials. Always have been, actually. They just thought if people knew about it, it would undermine their authority, which is a valid point. It's valid. You can look at that charitably. It's valid to say that, because people might get real curious about extraterrestrials. Oh, what can they offer us? And then, of course, the Vatican does. They can offer us all these gadgets and technology that, you know, would lead people astray. And so there's some valid reasons to keep that under wraps. You could say that. But at some point, you know, is it still wise to keep it under wraps? At some point, it becomes ridiculous. I mean, it might become more effective to say, no, we have to know what's going on here. And the New World Order is very much an extension of reptilian belief and technology. Draco, you know, this is the devil in Christianity, the devils. They're always reptilian in nature. Oh, yeah, of course. There is this reptilian race and many other races besides, but they're the ones they have this vast cosmic centralized bureaucracy. And they say, look, we know how to streamline everything really great. And just let us help you out and we'll streamline this world. And of course, the Vatican would be tempted to say, wow, that could help us too. So they may be playing along with this, thinking that they'll get the capacity to streamline their institution and keep all the bishops in line and everybody on the same page and then have this vast spiritual success. But it doesn't really work that way. For example, did Ananda Mayama try to streamline everything? No. She worked with each individual individually, actually, and said, look, everybody's in a different place, and what I say to one might be different than what I say to another. Don't think that I'm establishing some centralized body of teaching here, necessarily, because if you look at her teaching, some of them are just hard to understand. What is she really saying? She can't just, here she says this, and here she says something different. This is typical among teachers. But the emphasis is on practice, everyday practice, which is the key teaching. And that she never wavered at all. Never wavered at all. Everyday practice. Now, Catholicism has the Eucharist, and they ask you to come every day for that. The Eucharist is very similar to the Yidam practice of Vajrayana, Tibetan Buddhism, of visualizing the deity, visualizing the deity, and then merging with it, visualizing the qualities of God, divinity, in a form, and then ultimately merging with it. You have the generation stage of visualization, and the completion stage, which is merging with it. That this is you. Realize this is what I am. The Eucharist is supposed to be the deity, Jesus Christ. And we're supposed to visualize that this Eucharist truly is the body and the blood, meaning the actual divine qualities of Jesus Christ. And then eating it is, we're supposed to then become Christ. So it's the same practice, basically, just a slightly different symbolic format. And they do want you to, they have Eucharist every single day. So they do have the principle of everyday practice there. So a lot of the form of practice is there in Catholicism. But the spirit of it, you know, is there's a tug of war over that, really. The escape velocity, the intent, is not there. It is not there. I'm directly experiencing all of this. It's not there. So this would lead to feeling that they feel they need to centralize their bureaucracy more, which means they're going to go along with the New World Order, which is this super high-tech centralization, which the United Nations, so you have the United Nations going along with this, the Vatican going along with it, certainly the political apparatus of Western nations, many nations in the world are going along with this, which is going right into this draconian trap of the draconian saying, we know how to get rid of the bad absurdity. You just make this super bureaucracy, super regulation of everybody, and all badness will be monitored. And we'll know if somebody used too much energy here, or if they had this thought here, or that. We'll just monitor everything. Complete police state, essentially, is what we're really being led into. And the Vatican thinks, well, if we just get that going, and we really streamline everything, then we can get back to, you know, the real substance of what this is about. No, because then it'll be too late. It's like making a deal with the devil. I mean, this is the danger that I see very clearly, and many other also see this. They're feeling this. Say, wait a minute. It's like, hey, yeah, we can get all this technology, but then they'll leave us alone. Really? Is that how it works? Yeah, well, then we'll drive them off. We'll be so powerful. Is that how it actually works, though? Right? It's like Adam and Eve. So again, it's likely the Vatican is outsmarting itself, okay? And these political hacks are outsmarting themselves. They're saying, don't worry, we can handle the reptilians. We know, really, they know how to? Well, Jesus will get rid of them. Really? Is that exactly what's going to happen? So we think, we're thinking, oh yeah, we'll get all this stuff and we'll have this massive bureaucracy and we'll all be able to then succeed. And then Jesus will come in and with archangels and have this battle and defeat the reptilians, and but then we'll have all this technology. You know, this is what they're really banking on. This is what they're banking on. So we just need to be aware of this. Is that a wise bet to make? You don't think the reptilians know that this is the way we're scheming? The world is scheming like this. You don't think they're aware of that? You don't think that they've promulgated a false image of Jesus to lead us right into this trap of theirs? You don't think they have the guile to do that? You don't think they've been working for thousands of years to distort and twist with the message of Jesus so that they could lead us in this trap of thinking that we can depend on Jesus to come back as a warrior and destroy the reptilians, so we don't need to worry about that. We can get all their technology and they'll be fine. You don't think that they're the ones that are not behind all that in the first place? You don't think absurdity is not behind the plans of absurdity? And then, of course, and they said, well, we have this as such a nice pope, such a nicely. How could you say that? Really? Now, one way the Vatican has tried to extend its bureaucracy is to get rid of all these saints, these local saints, where the people actually have contact with them, and the saints can actually teach directly from their own direct experiencing of perfection. What they've done is they've tried to centralize everything by lumping all these great saints of Christianity into what? Into the Virgin Mary. So the church is frantically promoting the Virgin Mary, or the Virgin of Guadalupe. Here in the States, is a Virgin of Guadalupe is everywhere in the Catholic Church. It's amazing. You're supposed to cover up the altar. The Virgin of Guadalupe has massive display on the very altar, right in front of Jesus, and they cover up Jesus to do this. So what they're saying is, from the Vatican standpoint, from a bureaucratic standpoint, it's more important that the bureaucracy and institution continues than it is to teach the teachings of Jesus. So we'll cover him up and use this goddess motive, the mother motive, which everybody, you see, that's the lowest common denominator of everyone is your mother. Like when you're in trouble, you turn to the mother. If you're a child, you feel threatened, you think, oh, where's mom to save me? So they feel institutionally threatened. They're feeling threatened by the reptilians. So they're saying, if we all band together, you know, but how do we do this? We need to get people away from their sectarianness. So they use this mother figure to try to unite everybody. This is what they've been doing. But in doing so, we lose touch with our own path. Now, see, they tried to get me to help out. They said, we're endangered by these reptilians. I said, that's true. But the question is how to get free of this is the question. And they wanted me to help use the Virgin Mary as a symbol to unite all of Christianity. And they said, you need to reach out. We need to all band together, unite together, both the Protestants and Catholics. I mean, the ecumenical band together to defeat the reptilians. Okay. This is what... Let me just stop here for a minute, because this is very wowish. This is true. They said, you're capable of doing this. I said, well, theoretically, but is this what needs to be done, actually? Or is it better that we each have our own empowerments and our own path and our own ability to full stop in the wow? Doesn't that make it more difficult for the reptilians to institutionalize and bureaucratize everything? I mean, it seems to be that the Virgin Mary thing is leading everybody into the very trap that the reptiles want us to be led into. And they may be the very ones behind all of that. Absolutely. And I found out they are. I looked into this. I said, wow. They're the ones sponsoring this. They want us already familiar with this institutionalized bureaucracy. So when they take over, we'll say, oh, it's not much different than what we've been used to in the first place. So the way to institutionalize us is to get us focused on the mother. It's common denominator. The reptilians realize that's the most potent common denominator that they can get us hooked on. They want all inner empowerment, whatever power it's. No, it has to come from the Virgin Mary. It's amazing how they're de-emphasizing Jesus more and more. Because from a survival standpoint, they see that as a tactical step they need to take. But they first distorted Jesus to such an extent that they now think that that's perfectly okay to take that step. But this distortion came from the reptilians, came from absurdity in the first place. And then the remedy also came from them. So we're being led into this very devious trap. This is one way to look at it. Okay, we're looking at it like this. If you want to have blind faith, then you can say, well, they have it all under control, right? No problem. If you want to be extremely charitable, you say they're outsmarting themselves. If you want to be realistic, you say they're leading everyone right into the trap the reptilians want them to do. They're doing the work for them. This is what the reptilians do. They get us to do their work for them. They're very good at that. They get us to imprison ourselves. They get us to get used to this rigid bureaucracy of super and superficial spirituality, all this, and then we're already familiar with it, then they can move in and it's smooth for them. They like their control to be easy. They like easement too, you know. We all want easement. So don't think the reptilians don't want easement. Of course they do. They get us to do the dirty work, the hard work for them. You know, this is their cleverness. Cleverness of absurdity. And Jesus is already back here, and he said, I just came to relate with you as a friend. Not to set up some great institutional bureaucracy at all. Not to assume the head of this bureaucracy. Not at all. So I announced this to the world, and there's really no reaction to the world. The world is like, it's not what they expect, because the draconians have shaped our expectations through the ages so they can take over this world. When they plan to take over a world, they're planning in terms of thousands of years. When they want to assert their dominance, they decide, okay, we want this world to be part of our empire in terms of a major base for us. They plan thousands of years ahead. And so they work gradually on corrupting truth. They work, try to get it ready for them. They prepare it. Prepare the soil. Till the soil. So they've been tilling the soil here for quite some time. Planting the seeds. So that we will welcome them as saviors at some point. This is what they're really aiming for. They want us to beg for them. Please help, help, help. We really need you as saviors. They want to create confusion here. Catastrophes and confusion. So then we'll plead for a centralized bureaucracy. It says, oh my gosh, nothing's working anymore. We need to... I mean, everybody's already addicted to smartphones and all what they're, you know, these addictions that they have now. Be easy for them. They'll just say, well, you need to do this and this and this if you want us to help out. Okay, we'll do it. So we do all the work, and then they come and say, well, yeah, you've done a pretty good job here, and I'll just be here to make sure you keep it that way. And before you know it, they're in charge, they're in control. It's become their base for further expansion of absurdity. It's just all a dream of absurdity. And they'll give us a little pat, like make us think like maybe we won. Well, they're at least they're not as bad as we thought. And they've changed their way. We helped integrate them into this world. You know, we'll put a rationalization spin on it. Like, wow, they're not as bad as we thought. Yeah. And they'll give us ways to rationalize it. Of course. That's their business. That's what they do. That's how they have extended their empire. They're so clever at it. This is why the real teachings in this world come in to make it more difficult on them and liberate ourselves from this stupid dream, absurdist dream. Jesus always said the adversaries are very clever indeed. Must be aware of this. You must not be naive. And it's really just our own absurdity, the dance of our own absurdity, the dance of our own continuity fear. So we're bringing to light very important information here. Just to look at it. We're just looking at it in the wow here. Not advising any actions, you know, at this point. We're just, there's a time to say, okay, well, what do we do about it? But not when we're looking at it. But that's the wow time. It's like, wow, we can really see this. We don't realize the corruption that has happened, how badly it's happened. And we've taken some of these to be truisms. And then we reason from that. We say, okay, well, this must be okay then. And the church is turning more and more and more and more to works, which of course the reptilians love that. They want everybody cleaning up their mess. They want everything to be very charitable here because they're putting us under such extreme, terrible, absurdist pressures that everybody's going to have mental breakdowns. So they want a big system of charity working here in the world. They want that to be what the church is all about now. Instead of genuine spiritual teaching. And the church could say, well, we maintained our bureaucracy here. We maintained our institutions. Everything's fine. Yeah, but there's no baby anymore. There's just the bathwater. We threw out the bathwater. There's no baby. There's nothing there. There's no truth there anymore. And they say, well, the truth is the institution is still standing. That is the truth. But this is not giving any teaching out, actually. So it's an absurdist institution. This is institution of absurdity is what? Absurd. It's absurd. And they'll reinterpret all Jesus' miracles, this and that, in the technological way. And people say, oh, okay, so that's what he did. It was a trick. It was all this or all that or whatever. And absurdity, you know, marches on. Going nowhere. Going absolutely nowhere. As Jesus puts it, aimless wandering. Aimless wandering. Meaningless, aimless wandering is all that's taking place. That's all absurdity does. Just wanders aimlessly around. never getting anywhere, actually. So, we'll see what Jesus says. He's very much important in terms of how things go forward, what's going to happen ultimately. Very important. Very much dialed into the whole situation. I don't have any updates exactly. I guess, I have to keep clarifying what's going on first. Before the notion of what's the effective route to take here becomes, readily apparent, easily and readily apparent. I just have to, I have faith and trust that will happen. Just have to keep clarifying, like, wow, what's going on? Is this a trap? Is this a trap? I say it's the cleverest trap ever. It's just the most worst trap ever. This is one way of looking at it. We can certainly look at it this way. Now, is that paranoia? Well, we can look at it other ways. And I've given you the different gradations of looking at it. And I say that depends on one's continuity fear, how we will look at it. Are we entering a golden age? Or are we just outsmarting ourselves? Or is this just a terrible trap? That's different ways of looking at it. And if we can look at all three of these ways clearly, how is that paranoia? It's not paranoia. It's just seeing and then explaining why we would see it different ways. And I'm saying because of continuity fear, different levels of continuity fear. And from the level of severe continuity fear, thinking, well, everything's just great. It's all okay. This is, we're not... blind faith. It looks at those who see, oh, this is a terrible trap we're being led into, and say, oh, they got paranoia. It's just paranoia. Meaning, if I thought that way, they're saying, if I thought that way, I would be completely freaked out. Because I'm not prepared yet. My continuity fear would say, there's an abyss, and you're asking me to jump into abyss. Because if they saw it that way, it's a terrible trap. They'd say, well, I got to get free of it. And they have no notion of how to get free of it. And so they think they just have to leap into an abyss. So they call it paranoia. So, oh, you must be paranoid. That kind of thing. So they put... This is what happens. It's their own fear of freedom being projected onto the situation. So they say, no, we don't need to do anything about it. We'll just stay right here and everything's just going to be wonderful. And turn a blind eye to what's going on. Just blind faith. God's in control. Everything's going to be wonderful. God's in control of reality. God's not in control of absurdity, so to speak. The Holy Spirit, is perfectly aware of how to save us from absurdity. But the idea that the dance of absurdity is somehow God's dance is not a good way of looking at it. Because the dance of absurdity entails massive terror, fear of an abyss, always, and how to avoid that abyss, always, and then always effort to get rid of the bad absurdity and keep the good, so there's not an abyss. You see, it entails this massive activity, an enslavement, really, based on fear enslavement. It entails all of that. That's how it dances. To say that, well, God's in control of it isn't going to make it any less fearful of a dance for us, any less suffering of a dance for us. Absolutely not. That's really just a way of saying, well, I'm in control. Absurdity's in control of it. So everything's fine. Absurdity is God. That's really what they say. Well, God's in control. They're saying absurdity is God. Therefore, God's in control of absurdity. Everything's fine. It's going to work out great for me. And yet then we're confronted with all the misery and suffering and tragedy around us, and we say, but how do I square that up with my belief everything is working out great here? Then we have to use duality of, well, there must be bad absurdity here. See, this is why people struggle so much with their theology. It's taking absurdity as God. And then they have this, can't square up the theology, they can't round, smooth out the theology at all. They say, well, why do bad things happen to good people? You're going to get all this ruminations. Now, the good side of Catholicism, it is just like pretty streamlined, one absurdity kind of thing. I mean, there's a lot of absurdity in there, but it's all the same absurdity, keeps being taught over and over. The problem with Protestantism is you get all these different ministers and pastors and stuff, hundreds of thousands of them, and they're all presenting different types of absurdity, basically. And so it's like, how do you, oh my gosh, here's another one, you know. So it's almost easier to see through Catholic absurdity than it is to see through Protestant absurdity. Really. Because every Protestant is, you know, writing a book, all these pastors, not just one book, tens and tens, oh, so many writings and teachings, so many. How come good things happen to bad people? Why is God doing this? Well, you see, God is like this, or God is like that. We don't quite understand this. It's a mystery. We got to have faith. And all these tortured explanations. I mean, in Protestantism, there's thousands and thousands of very tortured explanations. Whereas in Catholicism, there's just one basic tortured explanation. It's just trust us. You know, it's a mystery. That's it. Take the Eucharist. It's all a mystery. So in a funny way, Catholicism saved me from Protestantism. Yeah, it's easier to see through Catholicism than Protestantism. The idea behind Protestantism was a good one. But again, continuity fear creates all sorts of obstacles, doesn't it? You get every single pastor says, I got to figure it out. Listen to what I got to say. And so you read it, and you spend all this time, and you realize they're completely confused. It's absurd what they're saying. And then another one says, I got it all figured out. You read that, another absurdity. See, so I spent so many years and so much, an unbelievable amount of time reading all this stuff. There's all different styles of absurdity. Whereas in Catholicism, it's just like this one basic style of absurdity. Let's just keep it kind of this basic style of absurdity. That you just say, wait a minute, this is absurd what you're saying. It's not working. You know? Okay, I get it though, I can see it. Very funny. Now, if you have the clarity to see through this, if you don't, then it's a trap, right? So it's sort of like, if you don't have much clarity, Catholicism seems to work for you, but it turns out to be a trap in the end. If you have sort of medium clarity, then Protestantism seems to work for you. If you have high clarity, then you can actually go back to Catholicism, which saves you from the medium clarity nonsense, and then you can get free of all of it. That's how I see how it's happened. So you can say in that way, the quote-unquote Virgin Mary was used in a positive way, you see. Coming to Catholicism and seeing just the overall absurdity of it without having to wade through infinite alternative explanations ended up saving me time. But this is all a play of God's grace. It's the Holy Spirit is doing all this, actually. So the Holy Spirit is able to use all this stuff to speed up our liberation from absurdity. The liberation from the idea that there's any need for liberation. To speed that up. And it seems kind of confusing as we go through it. And of course, in Buddhism, they have the three gradations of readiness. You know, the low clarity that's interested in just getting a better rebirth next life. The medium one that's interested in just their own liberation. And then the bodhisattva one, the highest ideal of liberating, wanting to help everybody out and liberate everyone. Not just themselves, but they want to liberate everyone. And then the highest of that is liberate everyone first. the good shepherd that Jesus represents, have put everyone else's welfare ahead of their own, even if it causes their own death. That's the highest bodhisattva ideal. So in Buddhism, they have that. They talk about, you know, levels of clarity, which is really just levels of continuity fear, actually. How much continuity fear is there? And then there's others that are just not even, all they're interested in their own self-interest, and they don't even talk about that. They're not even on the path. They don't view them as being on the path at all. So with Catholicism, you have those who want to be born in, after they die, go to a nice heaven. It's really like a nice rebirth, a nice life after death, okay? That's pretty much it. Then you have those that, in Protestantism, that really want to be one with Jesus, okay? They want to be liberated from suffering. They want to be saved, really want to be saved. That's more of an evangelical Protestant sort of thing. And then you have those who want to see that everyone be liberated right now. And that's the high path, the bodhisattva path. And at some point, this has to get free of the middle path. Not the middle, but the liberation from myself, be saved, I'm saved, Jesus saved me sort of thing. Of Protestantism, going back to Catholicism, actually helped get free of that middle gradation of continuity fear. Very interesting. But I mean, I go to Mass, but I'm different than the people there, most of, right? I mean, I don't take the Eucharist, because I'm not into that sort of practice, which is, you know, ultimately based on the high practice, apparently of Vajrayana Buddhism, that came from high understanding. There must be some way, you know, of doing that that's been effective. But it's very dependent on right instruction and guidance, very much so. Right conditions, etc. So I say, I don't do that. So I don't take the Eucharist. But the Catholics leave me alone. They don't bother me. Everyone treats me nicely. Everyone just ignores me, basically. There's no animosity or anything anywhere. And then I'm able to just recognize what's going on and get a bigger picture of everything here. Like, wow, okay. But I'm not ignorant of the ex-pope, excommunicated pope, Francis, what's his name? Broglio or something? Mario Broglio or something like that. I could see, you know, what's going on much more clearly than a normal Catholic would. They can feel it. Some of them can feel it, but they still toe the line. They do what the bishop tells them to do. The priests do what the bishop tells them to do. And there's a tug of wars with the bishops and the Vatican's going on between the conservatives and the progressives, so to speak. And the progressives say, hey, we need to make a treaty with the reptilians. We need to keep functioning here, keep this institution going. Whereas the Protestants are saying, hey, we're out of here, rapture time. We're not going to make a deal with the devil. Okay, that's their perspective. But their perspective is more of just, you know, I'm going to be raptured, we're all going to be with Jesus in a happy afterlife, whatever, whatever. Now, that's not necessarily wrong. My perspective is reduced intensity zone, a reduced intensity zone, shifting to that. So they don't really have the rapture worked out very clearly, you know, what to do. But that's what they don't want to stay here in a world, a reptilian dominated world. The Protestants, they don't want to. Although the that's being undermined severely, as if they're somehow, you know, evil, not to want to leave here. You know, what's wrong with you? That kind of thing. And the reptilians are trying to put into the leadership structure of the Protestant churches their own agents to subvert it all and turn it into turn them into just good works sort of thing, right? That's how you're saved, through good works, not by being raptured. The reptilians don't want anybody escaping because they said that we can't control them. If they're not here, how can we control them? They love control. So they want to control you. They don't want you in some reduced intensity zone where they have no authority. Because the idea of not controlling it to them is an abyss. So you disappearing, shifting to a reduced intensity zone for the reptilians, they think you've gone into the abyss, which means they believe there is an abyss. You know, you can't, and the abyss might come and get them. You know, they can't control it. Whatever they can't control, they see as an abyss. Whatever they cannot dominate, they see as an abyss. The abyss of space. So they're frantically trying to conquer space. Control space. We need... So... They don't want anyone to leave here. That terrifies them. They're paranoid about it. The question, who's paranoid? You know, it's the reptilians who are paranoid. Not the ones who want to ascend or rapture or shift into a reduced intensity zone. They're just pragmatists. They're not paranoid. They're not paranoids. They're pragmatists. It's the reptilians who are paranoid. Oh, if we can't control someone, they're going to come and attack us, sneak attack us sometime. Oh, that's paranoia. Paranoia. They're the ones who have severe paranoia. And it comes out in their attitudes of sudden outbursts of temper tantrums. See, reptilians can seem to be very smooth and suave and sophisticated and you know, that way and stuff. But they're paranoids. Okay, this has to be understood. So you think you can make a deal with them, and you're talking with rational beings here, and everything's fine. They have a severe streak of paranoia in them. And when something triggers that paranoia, then they go crazy. They go crazy. And so they're pressuring those who don't have that so severely to try to make them snap. So, and then they say, no, you're the ones who are paranoid and snap, not us. This is the game that they're playing here, trying to break the spirit of everyone here. But no, they're very paranoid. They're not pragmatic, they're paranoid. That if they don't control everyone, their sneak attack is going to happen on them. The abyss is going to gobble them up suddenly. They're afraid that this abyss has some sort of power to get them. Of course, this abyss is just truth. So they're paranoid of truth. Of course absurdity is paranoid about truth. What else could it be? It's truth is everywhere. It's out to get them. But they can't even see it coming. So this is the play here. The Catholicism doesn't teach the rapture. They do not. They do not. They say Jesus is coming back at some point and we'll have this lovely millennium. He'll be in control of it all. But this is a reptilian story, okay, about Jesus coming back and setting up his kingdom here. That's a distortion. Jesus never said he would set up his kingdom here. He never said that. And when he left, he said, this world is not my kingdom at all. This is the place of the devil. And when I come back, it's not to set up my kingdom, but to take you to the dwelling place I have prepared for you, which is, you know, way, way superior in this place. That's what he said. But the reptilians have tried to get everyone's attention on misemphasis, thinking that he's coming back to defeat the reptilians and set up his kingdom here. That's a lie. And it plays right into their hands. So they have set up the opposition to be the way that they want it to be. So, you know, they're just saying, give the devil its due. Give the reptilians their due. They're clever. But not that clever. It's completely blatant, actually. For them, it's just business as usual. They don't say anything big deal about it. They get a kick out of fooling us, you know. It makes them feel powerful. Helps ward off the abyss in their minds. You know, they don't think they're that clever. They look at us like, what a bunch of idiots, you know. They look at us like we're idiots. How easy we fall for this nonsense. I mean, they know it's like, they know it's nonsense at some level, right? Just like the snake oil salesman knows they're selling snake oil, really. And they look at the people, it's a bunch of schmucks, you know, what? They're buying this stuff? Wow, well, they deserve to get tricked then. If they're that stupid, then I don't need to have any compassion or pity on them. I'll keep selling the snake oil. That's a rationalization of absurdity. This is how absurdity rationalizes it all. So nice taping this morning. Haven't had work this morning. It's raining. Hopefully some work this afternoon. Need it. But this is great work here. And so I keep saying, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Can you not give us an update? And he may be saying, well, when you're ready, I will. And he knows his business, so I just have to trust in it. And just keep working at this. And not get too frustrated. Sometimes I get frustrated. I say, what are you waiting for? Well, he's got a reason to. I mean, you know, my mind can only handle so much truth. As long as there's continuity fear, without having a breakdown, it may physically cause me. I get like shingles and hives, or whatever they call it. I started coming back yesterday. It was so unnerving that the progress is very stressful. Can be. So he's just biding his time. And said, "When you're ready, I'll clue you in." Just like I said, I'm back. I clued you into it. Okay. So I expect that. I expect it. So just keep working at this. Just keep hearing it. Getting familiar with this. Say, wow, there is a perspective like this. So. And it'll get better. The perspective will get better. We'll get wiser. Here, we'll get wiser. This takeover of this planet has been in plans for a long time, and Jesus knew all about it thousands of years ago. So he gave us a heads up, a warning. This is what's good. Eventually they'll move on this plan. They have a very sneaky plan, and they'll instituting it here, and they will move on this plan, and this is how it's going to go. As again, I said, they plan thousands of years in advance. They have a long-term plan. We got to take over the space. We got to colonize space. So Earth is a convenient place for them at this point. This planet, for helping control other sectors of space. So they see it as and of course they like their planets to be a certain way. Resorts, these hedonistic resorts and stuff, they want it to be with a little tinge of spirituality. Of course they want to feel good about their absurdity, so they want to have all sorts of ways to feel good about their absurdity. And so they're having us set it all up for them in advance. So when they arrive here, all the amenities are here for them. They don't want to do the work. They say, we don't need to do the work. You want us to help you out? You do all the work and set up the world so we want to come here. They've tricked us into that. So we just go, in the wow when we don't have anything to say. Just wow. I can see that. It's like wow. But when we see it, we're not no longer really so fooled by it, are we? We just say, okay, very clever, very blatant though. So Jesus gave us this heads up because they planned so far in advance. So it's nothing for them to say, okay, in a couple thousand years we'll work to take over this planet. And maybe they'll be able to plan, another 10,000 years we'll have this sector of space, we'll use this. So they plan in terms of thousands and thousands of years. And this is what we have trouble with. Spirit inherently doesn't need to plan at all, actually. It's spontaneous. So it's easy for us to get trapped by this advanced planning of theirs. So Jesus says, rely on my plan. Okay, I'll have a plan for you too. But meanwhile, just practice and clarify. Don't think about a plan for the future here. Like, how is the world, how do I want this world to be? He says, I have a plan for you, okay? And this is what Christians are taught, that Jesus has a plan. And have faith in that plan. But don't try to figure out what it is, because we have trouble with planning, right? So at some point, there will be whatever clarification we need will take place. We don't want to lose our spontaneity. We don't want to get an absurdism of planning. But the Holy Spirit and Jesus, they understand from the standpoint of continuity fear that has to be properly countered, what the reptilians are doing, and the other, they have a lot of people working for them. A corporation sort of thing. We need to be able to handle a reduced intensity zone in our mind. Say, okay, wow, how nice. And be able to fit in, continuity-wise, fit in with that. So this is what our focus needs to be. It's just how do we acclimatize, how do we fit in familiarity-wise with a reduced intensity zone? Okay, so that's sufficient for this one. I feel that we've really done a great job at this. And, you know, I try to be spontaneous, so I'm not going to say, oh, will I do more? You know, what is going to happen in the future? I can't say that. I just spontaneously, opportunities arise, I make the most of the opportunity, that's all. Get used to that. Opportunities, grace presenting opportunities, making the most of the opportunity. Let grace run the show, okay? Let the grace of God run our show. We do not get into our planning mind. When we try to counter reptilians through our own planning, we're just falling right into their trap. Because remember, we need to get to the realization we don't need to do anything. We don't need to make any plans at all. We're absolutely free. Freedom doesn't need to make any plans. Only absurdity. And the proper countering of absurdity comes from the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, not from us. Okay, not from us. We need to go with the flow of grace. So this is my advice to you, the final advice is go with the flow of grace in your life. Recognize the opportunity, take the opportunity, which I've done right here with this taping. I said maybe it's going to be raining, maybe no work. Let me be ready for work, but tape in the meantime, tape. Beautiful. Thank you, Holy Spirit. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit carry out its plans, and we'll just go along with them. All right, very great. That's it.